Hachette Audio presents Soul Boom, Why We Need a Spiritual Revolution. Written and read by me, Rainn Wilson. Dedication. For my dad, Robert Wilson. Thanks for teaching me about the soul. Preface. From Mary Oliver. Instructions for living a life. Pay attention. Be astonished. Tell about it. Here I am, sitting in my office during the early weeks of the COVID-19 quarantine, furiously outlining the book on big spiritual ideas that I've been wanting to write for years. Now's my chance, I say to myself, while wearing the same sweatpants I've worn for the past 6 days with the little stain where I wiped my cinnamon raisin oatmeal on my thigh. Here's the big opportunity. Hours and hours of free time to vomit forth a potpourri of ideas on all of my favorite topics. The journey of the soul, life after death, the big guy upstairs, and the personal and spiritual transformation of society. The only problem? Me, Rainn Wilson. Let me be blunt with you, dear listener. I know what you might be asking right now. Why the hell is the actor who played Dwight on The Office writing a book on spirituality? First, let me explain what I mean by spirituality. True story. I recently came across a news headline about some model celebrity who had undergone some kind of spiritual transformation. I was intrigued. After all, I love spiritual transformations. Have had a couple myself over the decades. In fact, I might be having one right now as I narrate this. Upon further reading, it turns out that this model celebrity had undergone an actual exorcism of some kind in a remote town in Switzerland. A shaman had released some kind of demon energy from them, and they were finally on the other side of it, able to practice self-care and enjoy yoga and raw juicing from home. Something like that. Which got me thinking about the word spirituality. It can mean so many different things to so many people. To some, spirituality is completely synonymous with religious practice and organized religion, church, God, and so forth. To others, it can mean rituals involving hallucinogens. To many, because the word spirit is in it, it means that ghosts are involved. To still others, like the model celebrity in the article, it can mean exorcisms by Swiss shamans. Let me be perfectly clear. I'm not talking about any of that. The word spirituality, as the Oxford English Dictionary defines it, means the quality of being concerned with the human spirit or soul as opposed to material or physical things. This is exactly what I'm talking about. Way to go, OED. I will delve into all these concepts in far greater detail as the book progresses, but if we are to believe, as I very much do, that we have some kind of soul that continues on some kind of journey after our bodies fall away, and that this spiritual essence of who we are is just as real, if not more so, than our bodies. In other words, that this soul is the non-animal, non-material, non-pleasure and power-seeking dimension of ourselves that continues in some form after our physical existence ceases. And if this soul exists, then there are certain practices, processes, and perspectives that might help to shape our human beingness, the reality of who we really are. This is what I'm referring to when I talk about the word spirituality, this eternal/divine aspect of ourselves that longs for higher truth and journeys toward heart-centered enlightenment and, dare I say it, God. But let's go back to the original theme. Why does the guy famous for playing a weird, officious nerd in one of America's most beloved TV comedies, as well as many other offbeat characters, want to write about the soul, religion, the afterlife, sacredness, and the need for society to undergo a spiritual reimagining? Why is the beet-farming, paper-selling, tangentially Amish man-baby with the giant forehead and short-sleeved mustard shirts writing about the meaning of life? Well, I'll tell you one thing. It certainly is not because I have anything figured out. I'm no authority on spirituality, religion, or holiness, and I'm anything but enlightened. Yes, I've read and studied a great deal. I've suffered deeply. I've pondered and contemplated and meditated. I've struggled and many times failed. But aren't writers on spiritual topics supposed to have life all worked out? Well, I'm here to tell you that we don't. Although I have some insights from the work I've done, I still get anxious and confused a great deal. I swear too much. I'm impatient with my kids sometimes. I have a big ego that can sometimes subsume me. I compare and despair. I have been and can be overwhelmingly selfish and judgmental. Just ask my wife, who, by the way, is far more preternaturally spiritual than I am, believe you me. But let's keep digging a little bit. Why is a former sitcom actor writing some big idea text on spiritual transformation? And why am I, shameless plug, at approximately the same time hosting a travel documentary series on finding happiness called Rainn Wilson and the Geography of Bliss for the Peacock streaming service? Before I answer that question, I want to share some context. My life story, the story of my journey toward being an actor, a member of the Baha'i faith, and a spiritual student, thinker, enthusiast, as told in full in The Bassoon King, my serio-comic memoir of 2015, is a complicated one. My parents, like so many of their generation, were artsy bohemians in the 60s and 70s, on a quest for truth, peace, and meaning in their lives. My birth mother, Shay, formerly Patricia, of Wyawega, Wisconsin, moved to Seattle and became an actress in experimental theater in the late 60s. She did a play once while topless with her torso painted blue, running around the aisles and swearing at the audience. My father, the recently deceased, more on that later, Robert Bob Wilson of Downers Grove, Illinois, was a painter of abstract art and an author of science fiction novels, among various other pursuits. He would often blast opera music from our 1970s stereo system. Why were stereos so big back then? While covered in turpentine and gesso, singing along off-key as he smooshed globs of outrageous color onto canvases. Paintings that very few would actually see, because he never really tried to sell any of them, so they would stack up in the basement like multicolored pizza boxes. During the day, he would manage a sewer construction office and dispatch rusty trucks to unclog the leaf-filled drains of Seattle. During his lunch breaks, he would haul out a little portable manual typewriter and clack away onto stacks of paper, unveiling over the span of 15 years around 11 tomes of sci-fi with such titles as Tentacles of Dawn, The Lords of After Earth, and Carissa of Doom. My stepmother, Kristen, who was mostly tasked with raising me, wore various vaguely ethnic shawls and capes and made fanciful animal-shaped silver jewelry that she sold at a stall at the Seattle Public Market. And as if that wasn't eclectic enough, on their off nights they would attend meetings of the Baha'i faith, of which they were adherents. They would pray and meditate and study holy texts with other spiritually curious Seattleites. And there were a lot of them back then. An important note about the Baha'i faith. Personally, after many years of review and reflection, I have come to embrace the religion of my youth and feel like it contains all kinds of relevant wisdom surrounding the issues we face, both as individuals and as a species sharing a planet. And while this book is greatly inspired by the Baha'i faith and many of the principal teachings of its founder, Baha'u'llah, I won't get too deep into the details of the religion in these pages. After all, this is not a book about the Baha'i faith or for Baha'is. It is merely shaped and influenced by some of its spiritual, mystical, and social teachings. Any student of history knows the late 60s and early 70s had a completely different energy than the vibe of the previous several decades. When the whole Norman Rockwell, Eisenhower, lily-white American dream, Doris Day, leave-it-to-beaver, crew-cut, post-World War II skyscraper of American culture and values was taken down by an explosive charge of race riots, Vietnam, various assassinations, rock and roll, countercultural love, and LSD, all of a sudden the world as it used to be didn't make sense anymore. People were searching for a different path. What do you do when the world as you know it falls to ashes at your feet? Well, the Beatles met with the Maharishi, Cat Stevens became a Muslim, Shirley MacLaine communed with ancient aliens, a young Steve Jobs studied Buddhism in India, everybody was kung fu fighting, and countless young people sought answers along non-traditional spiritual paths. Into this milieu was born gigantic, pasty baby, Rainn Wilson, That's me. My dad often told stories of the early 70s when he would be out and about and see, say, a group of young men on a street corner in fringy leather vests and long hair, passing a doobie, jaybird, or spliff, that's 70s terminology, around the circle, and he would approach them saying, "Hey guys, want to come over tonight to learn more about the Baha'i faith? To pray and study different spiritual traditions?" And instead of laughing at him or kicking the shit out of him, they would respond with great earnestness. "Sure, man. Sounds groovy. What time?" These spiritual gatherings in our home would include Buddhists and Sikhs and Muslims and Mormons, while our bookshelves became filled with books by and about Buddhists and Sikhs and Muslims. We would host prayer gatherings and deepenings in order to get deep. And, in addition to the many Baha'i-inspired songs, we would often literally sing Kumbaya, sometimes while holding hands in a patchouli-scented circle. When Jehovah's Witnesses would come to our door with pamphlets and Bibles, they would be invited in, and we would host an impromptu Bible study replete with pancakes. I remember one time when members of a particular sect of Christian Protestant came to our house on a Sunday afternoon, my father asked them to describe their concept of the kingdom of heaven. A well-groomed man with a Ned Flanders mustache said, sipping some coffee, "Well, sometime in the near future, there will be a great rumbling from above, lightning will strike, and there will be terrible storms. The sky will open up, and down will come Jesus Christ on a cloud with a great trumpet blast. There will be an incredibly beautiful city with gold and silver turrets that descends with angels on it, and this is the kingdom of God. The good Christians will get into the city, and it will float away with Jesus to be with God the Father, and the rest of the people will be left behind, left on earth to perish." And then he politely responded with something to the effect of, "What is the Baha'i concept?" My dad, a wise spiritual teacher and public speaker, responded, "Well, in a lot of ways it's very similar. There will be great storms and lightning and thunder, and the skies will open up. Down from a hole in the clouds doesn't come a city or Jesus or anything, but rather a bunch of bags of cement, some shovels and hammers, bricks and mortar and nails and lumber. And finally, at the very end, a note floats down on the breeze and lands on top of all of the supplies. It reads, 'Kingdom of God on Earth, build it yourself kit.'" I don't remember what happened after that, but I'll always remember the story. And I suppose, when all is said and done, that's what it's all about, no? Whether you believe in God or not, whether you're Christian or Baha'i or anything else, we're all down here doing our best to build a more loving, just, equitable, cooperative.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.